Blackstone Publishing presents Welcome Home by Lucia Berlin. This book is read by Hilary Huber. In memory of Fred Buck and Helene Dorn. Juneau, Alaska. They said it was a sweet, small house with many windows and sturdy wood stoves, screens taut against mosquitoes. It looked out on the bay, onto sunsets and stars and dazzling northern lights. My mother would rock me as she gazed down at the harbor, which was always crowded with fishing boats and tugs, American and Russian ore ships. My crib was in the bedroom, where it was either very dark or very bright all the time, she told me, without further explaining the long and short lengths of the seasons. The first word I spoke was light. Mullen, Idaho. My earliest memory is of pine branches brushing against a window pane. This house was in Coeur d'Alene, Idaho, at the Sunshine Mine. Massive oak trees had branches almost parallel to the ground, and squirrels raced back and forth on them as if on highways. I recently read that the scent of flowers, especially roses and lilacs, actually was much more intense years ago. Their perfume now diluted by hybridization. True or not, my remembered Idaho perfumes are more vivid than any flower today. The apple blossoms and hyacinths were literally intoxicating. I'd lie on the grass beneath the lilac tree and breathe until I became giddy. In those days, I would also spin around and around until I was so dizzy I couldn't stand up. Maybe these were early warning signs, and lilacs my first addiction. I had never heard about pussy willows, so I was astonished to see fir growing on a stalk. I waded the icy stream to reach them, soaking my shoes and clothes. I wasn't allowed to go outside after that. I might have drowned or been swept away. I slept on a Murphy bed. These were common then. Beds that closed up inside a closet during the day. There were no rugs and very little furniture in this big house. Creaks, echoes of wind in the trees, the splatter of rain against glass, sobs in the bathroom. At night, sometimes my parents played pinochle with neighbors. Laughter and smoke floated up the stairs to my room. Finnish and Swedish exclamations. Lovely, the cascade of poker chips and Morocco ice cubes. The particular way my mother dealt, quick hiss of a shuffle, a crisp slap, slap, slap as she laid down the cards. I watched the children go to school every morning, and later I could hear them playing kickball and jacks, spinning tops. I played inside with Skippy, my dog, a small coffee percolator tied to a bathrobe belt. My mother read mysteries. We both looked out of windows and watched it rain. At first, it is scary, then beautiful, when you wake up to the day of the first snow. My father came home from work tired and thick with grime, his eyes startled rings of white with emerald green inside. On Saturday evenings, we walked down the hill to town, a general store and post office, jail and barber shop, a drugstore, and three bars. We got a Saturday evening post and a giant-size Hershey bar. Sensible crunch of snow beneath our galoshes. We started home after dark, but it was as bright as day, with Idaho stars shattering the sky. The light of stars was definitely brighter then, too. Marion, Kentucky. Snow and cold that quickly turned into a sultry southern spring with catalpa, peach, and apple blossoms. Birds everywhere, irrepressibly jubilant. Butterflies. I had to stay on the boarding house veranda, which was painted glossy black and mopped by glossy negras. "Don't let her call them that," my father said to my mother. "I'm from Texas. Should I say darkies? Colored, for God's sake." The colored maids and cooks and waiters all talked to me. There were no other children at the boarding house. The miners in Marion were single men, Mexicans mostly, hundreds of them living in barracks. The people in the boarding house were engineers like my father, assayers, geologists.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.